The speed limit was 35 miles an hour. Now you think of I-35 right now, and that's probably why it was named I-35. The process was basically this, is that we would leave my grandmother's home in Minneapolis about 9 o'clock in the morning. We would drive at 35 miles an hour, and we would have a picnic pre-prepared, one of those wonderful picnic basket lunches in Moose Lake. We would arrive at the cabin about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. That was the way you traveled in World War II.
The roads, it was incredible. Yeah, Peter was right, it took all day. But even more than that, when we stayed at Hart's, my brother and I were put to bed. I mean, we were about four or six years old, you know. And then we would start out again. But the real terror was the tires. You knew you were going to have one flat and one gone tire. But what were you going to do when the second tire went? You had no place for two spare tires. It was simply a nightmare. Then when you got to Two Arbors, it was even worse because the road really disintegrated into just plain ruts at that point. But the upside of that was the hours we played with Billy Anderson sitting right in the same forester's cabin, the front stoop that looked out towards the highway. And we would play one entire summer with Toby, a deer that wandered in and just became their pet. We just spent hours there.
Grandpa Chapman, Joseph Chapman, who was, I think, not in the original group, but in what you might call the second wave, was involved at the bank, but he was also involved with the Soo Line Railroad. And there were occasions when Grandpa Chapman would get the private car on the Soo Line Road. And the big thrill, the biggest thrill of our lives as kids is the one or two or three times that we would get to go to encampment in the private car with the leather plush seats and William the waiter who loved me because he knew I liked bananas. I mean, this, so we would ride up on the Soo Line in this private car. And then Walter, who was the chauffeur, would meet us at the train station and would take us to the rest of the way to the cabin. This all goes to say there's more than one way to get to encampment.
The person who stood like a colossus in Camping Forest with Campy Anderson. My grandmother, all of the founders, they saw him as kind of a Paul Bunyan. I mean, and if you grew up listening to the probably lore, but in many ways facts about what Campy had done, if you read again the book of how many cabins he was involved in building and what happened, and he and his wonderful wife set a pattern that I think has been followed by Campy's successors all the way down.
Encampment has been, more than any other institution in my life, the most intergenerational place I've ever been. And I'm thinking here, as you talk about making fun, and I suppose the metaphor for me would be, for those of you who would remember, a place in Castle Danger called the Minocqua Valley. And every Saturday night there was the Minocqua Valley Hoedown. And we would go square dancing, and that comes to my mind as intergenerational because I think I danced, as kids we were this high, it didn't make any difference how old we were. And of course that was, again, the highlight for us. If we could get to the, we'd beg all week long to get to the Minocqua Valley Hoedown. And it's where we learned to square dance.
We would dam up creeks, we would skip stones, we'd throw driftwood out into the water and then try to, you know, bombard the wood out there. And indeed there was not the kind of organized activities that we see today. But you have to remember, as Ann mentioned, electricity didn't come to encampment until 1938. And it was almost an affront to have electricity put in, certainly not a telephone. By no means, well, television wasn't around. Some of you have come by our cabin, and I must admit, we have a dish. And see, it's that kind of reaction to electricity. We had kerosene lamps. The water was supplied by the springs, one of which I think is still got water in. And the timing of being up there was dependent upon when whoever it was could turn the water on and it wouldn't freeze.
Remember the party lines? That was the... I think we had 12 on a line or something. It was, that was a source of amusement at times.
On Labor Day, we would have... you'd go sign up, and we had badminton, ping pong, shuffleboard, tennis, putting, bridge. And of course, for the kids, it was kind of interesting because there were really two things that if you really wanted to establish yourself in that whole milieu of the Labor Day games was, one, and nobody ever had the courage to do this, but one was to enter the bridge tournament and try to defeat Mrs. Denman. Impossible. And the other one, which was didn't take quite as much courage, was to try to go down on the putting green and beat Mrs. Sheldon.
I can remember, and this is in the book, I can remember sitting on the board when John Budd, now here's John Budd Sr., who runs one of the biggest railroads in the country, the Great Northern Railway. And the Board of Governors spent about a half an hour because Bernie had come in and asked for an allocation to buy a new hammer. And the hammer was going to cost something like $10.25, and everybody had their own supplier who thought he could get it at a cheaper price. And we spent a half an hour on deliberating that. And that is one of the very unspoken but unique characteristics of this association. It's been run on a dime. It will continue to be run on a dime, notwithstanding, I'm sure. It's just the spirit of the place.
It was just absolutely amazing how everyone there, the members of Encampment Forest, were really there thinking about what this was not going to be like tomorrow or the next day, or what that forest was going to be like 25, 50, 100 years in the present, in the future, looking out for children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. And I just keep up the good work on the forest management plan because that's very, very important and it makes all sorts of sense. And again, there's no other place like it.
It's just wonderful to have people come up and to see the appreciation they have for being able to enjoy this place because it is so special. So I think that's one of the nice things is to be able to share. The River Cabin plays a major role in all of that, I think. To me, the River Cabin is an institution.
But there is no place, on the North Shore of Lake Superior that in any way will ever, ever, ever compare to Encampment Forest.